Hi friends, so as promised, I am with you. First of all, a big congratulations to all of you. You are starting a new journey in your life, from a student life to a full-blown doctor. All of you are becoming a radiologist, and I can tell you that this is one of the best decisions that you have taken in your life, that you have picked up radiology. So lot of students have this problem because they don't know about radiology during the undergraduation. They have picked up radiology. Some people wanted to do radiology. Some people picked up radiology because they thought that they have got a great rank and that is why they have to pick it up, but they have no idea. Some people have picked up radiology, but they are now getting this peer pressure that whether they are doubtful whether they have taken a right decision or not. Some have this doubt that what should they do over a period of time. So to address all these issues, today I have invited Dr. Lalendra Upreti. Just to inform you, Dr. Lalendra Upreti was the head of the Department of University College of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. And sir has changed the Department of University College of Medical Sciences like anything. I have seen University College of Medical Sciences Radiology Department in the last 10-15 years. And I can tell you that when the sir took over Department of University of Radiology at UCMS, I used to say this to the student that in terms of academic, that's the best department in Delhi. When sir was heading that particular department, in spite of the MRI was not there. Apart from that, sir has been the chairman of Indian College of Radiology and Imaging, the top academic wing for the radiology community at the Pan India level. So I have collected some doubts from the students, and let's hear from the sir that what is the Dr. Upreti's opinion. So first of all, sir, welcome to the platform, and thank you very much for accepting my request that you have accepted to address the students.
Thank you very much for providing me this opportunity, Dr. Rajat. It's always great and it's always informative and educative for me also to talk to students, know about their concerns, and to be able to do something as a radiology student and teacher myself. And now I have this added privilege of being the chairman, and as ICRI chairman, which is I'll be there for 2 years. We plan to do a lot of activity for radiology residents, so I am looking forward to this opportunity and to this session also.
Okay, so sir, first question that I want to ask you, sir, you have been an examiner of an MD postgraduate exam in radiology. So you must have visited almost all of the colleges, all different type of places. You have been an examiner for the DNB also. And you have been a teacher for a postgraduate residence in the University of Medical Sciences and as well as in the GP Panth Hospital. So what is expected from a radiology resident in the residency? Now, I'll tell you my own journey about the radiology. So when I joined radiology, I picked up radiology because everybody around me told me that if you get rank 1, you have to pick up radiology. So that was the whole idea of me picking up radiology. But when I picked up radiology, I had no idea that what is to be done in this particular branch. So I just want from a senior professor like you, that if a radiology resident is in front of you, what do you expect, that how much he should know and how should he or she plan in the radiology residency?
See, as far as how much one should know in radiology, it's a theoretical subject with huge reach across all clinical subjects. So knowing how much knowing, that is up to you, but definitely for in your day-to-day practice and also for passing your exam, you need to be very clear about basics. And as I see as a teacher, the main emphasis of student is to learn cross-sectional imaging. That is, they want to learn CT and MRI, and which of course eventually they learn in due course of time. But in exam, when I go there as an examiner, I find that quite a few students, they are lacking in the basic knowledge. So while the clinical decision making in the real world is definitely based on cross-sectional imaging, but if you want to have good strong fundamentals and if you want to have good performance in the exam, you need to be very clear about basics. And most of our classes which we conduct, which I conduct in our institute, in my institute and also at ICRI, focus on this very important aspect, that be very clear. Unless you have a very good foundation of conventional radiology, well, you will have problem in understanding various radiographs and various contrast studies, which will always be part of your examination to begin with. And remember, in exam, most of the viva would happen mainly on conventional. Very few people would ask you much about the cross-sectional imaging. So do learn cross-sectional imaging, and there is lot to be learned. But remember, especially in your first year, be very clear about your basic concepts are clarified. So be relentless, keep asking your seniors, keep asking them questions, and must take care of this, like if you want to be a good radiologist.
So that means, sir, the take home message that I will take here is that in the first year, rather than focusing on the CT and MR, the cross sectional, the first thing is that clear the concepts of a chest X-ray or the basic conventional studies like the IVPs and the barium studies, because these are the one that the examiners are very fond of asking.
Yes.
So even if you don't have an access of that CT and MR in the first year or the second year, then don't be disappointed on that particular part, because that will form the basic part of your radiology curriculum. And in fact, when your foundation of the basics of the ultrasound and the radiography and these special studies is strong, it will be easier to learn the CT and MR. So, yes. Is that the take home message that we can take from this?
Yes, that is, I think, in first year, I think what I feel that a first year student should have 6 months goal and 1 year goal. 6 months goal is to learn the radiographic anatomy, that is about chest, bariums, IVP, and in next 6 months about the cross sectional anatomy. See, you need to be very clear about your anatomy so that you are able to discern the pathologies. Sometimes if you see even on the conventional images and even on the cross sectional images, the abnormal findings are so subtle that unless you know your anatomy well, you may not be able to pick them up. And remember, these days lot of clinician, they are interested in radiology. There is tough battle going on in almost every field of radiology. They want to learn X-rays, they want to learn ultrasound. In fact, you know, ultrasound is our main focus area where this tough battle is going on. Almost all clinical specialty, they are learning ultrasound. And what would differentiate you from them is that you are able to pick up subtle finding, and that would need a very good knowledge of anatomy in conventional as well as cross-sectional imaging.
Yeah, in fact, sir, let me tell you, I'm not sure whether you're aware of that. Even in the exam now, the PG entrance exam, even they focus lot of stuff on the radio anatomy.
Yes.
Now in the images also, they have started giving lot of questions where they give a cross sectional structure and they ask the radio anatomy of that particular structure. So I think probably this is what the same thing that is coming up, that your anatomical understanding on a radiological image should be very, very strong.
So that's what I say, that you must know your anatomy. Once you know anatomy, you will be able to pick up the pathology, and once you pick up that there is an abnormality, then you have lot of resources to know what it is. You know, you have the clinical context, and then you have these findings, and lot of online resources are available. So that is not a problem. So just remember, in first year, be very clear about your conventional anatomy and the cross sectional anatomy.
Okay, good. So that is again a very, very important message that has come out, friends, that that even if you are not getting the CT and MR, see, because the moment you think about radiology as a residency, the first thing that comes to your mind is this cross sectional imaging. So don't think about this cross-sectional imaging, at least in your first year. Take care of your basics, learn the anatomy well on your radiological part, and if your anatomy is very, very strong, slowly and slowly you will move to the other part. So that means, again, the same point is follow the patterned approach. The patterned approach will be extremely helpful for all of you. So, sir, what is your recommendation that which books should be read during the radiology residency? I mean, there are so many books, there are so many things that are available. So what are your recommendations about the when a first year resident joins the radiology, what are the minimum books that one should focus on?
See, as I said, that in first year your emphasis should be in learning the anatomy. So for this, lot of online resources are available, and as far as standard textbook are concerned, there are few standard textbooks which cover, you know, broadly the topics of radiology. These are Granger and Allison. Sutton is also there. And then this AIMS MAMC PGI series is also quite good. So this is about an overall learning. And then we have specific books in various subjects if you want to go for, you know, advanced knowledge. And then you have online resources. And let me tell you, we have this free membership of RSNA, Radiological Society of North America, which is available to all the residents free of cost. Be a member there. They have a very good journal, Radiographics, which deals with the, you know, topics which are relevant to residents. So be a member as soon as you join the residency. Be a member there, and then you will have the, you know, access to this journal straight away. And from there also you can learn. It's a good learning material there.
So sir, according to you, that the student should start focusing on the journals from the first year itself?
Yes, yes.
They should.
Journal with the intent of, you know, learning the pathologies basically, right?
Okay.
You know, some journal they have very advanced research topic which may not attract you, may not be useful to you.
But it probably that gives you an idea that what is going on.
Yes.
In the radiology at the current level.
Yes.
So one book you said, the Granger or Sutton. So I think students should choose one of the book.
Yes.
What is your preference, that because a lot of students have this confusion that because they cannot read both the books, and I will again not suggest.
Yes, yes.
So what is your preference about these two books, that which one, if you are given a choice, then what will you suggest, or what you suggest to your residents in your college, that whether they should go with the Granger or whether they should go with the Sutton?
See, as a basic textbook, I think we need to read Granger as well as this AIMS and MC PGI series. These are the two good books which are good for, you know, basic knowledge. And as I said, then you have these online resources and also advanced book also there, subject wise, that is also there.
So sir, like you said that there are, one should focus on the basics.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember during our time, we tend to use everybody that Felsen, which is the book for the, basically for the chest x-ray. So any specific books like those that you will suggest that one should focus on? So Granger, yes, that's a standard, but it's a very, very broad book.
It's a very broad book. Yes, Felsen is very good. It, you know, tells you in great detail about the chest radiograph, what is the normal anatomy and how to pick up subtle finding by describing various signs. So as far as chest x-ray is concerned, it's a very good book. Well, regarding IVU and all, now because IVU is gradually, barium is also gradually becoming less and less, right? So not many books are available, so you may have to go to the old editions of, you know, in your library you will have old books which deals about the conventional radiology, and you can refer to that. So there are different books for different speciality, but definitely chest x-ray is the most important x-ray. You would be seeing it, you know, almost 50% of your practice would be on chest x-ray. So it's always good to have Felsen by your side.
Okay. The one book that you suggest that students should form a basic is Granger.
Yeah.
That one should read. Okay. And though one should not focus too much on the cross-sectional imaging, but we know that after the 4-5 months, we start getting postings in the CT, specifically in the emergency CTs. So any book like I remember during our days, the first CT that we learned to read is neuro CTs, the brain CTs. So any books for that, because ultimately, irrespective of the online source, till the time you don't have a standard book available with you, you don't get a feeling that you are reading. So any books on that?
Yes, for neuroradiology we have Osborne, and for, you know, general cross sectional imaging we have this Haga is there, and you know, then for chest cross sectional, although that would be too advanced, but I think for beginning, if you want to build up the basics of the anatomy and gross description of cross sectional finding in various pathologies, this Haga book is also quite good.
Haga.
And I think you are also a practitioner, you can also suggest few books.
Sir, what I will suggest is learn and read.
Yeah.
Is what I feel is probably one of the biggest aspects that at least I have done. What I used to do is I used to follow the basic books. Like as you said, Felsen was the one that book I have read at least 5-6 times, and every time when you read this particular book, you find something new.
Yeah.
In this is one of the most exhaustive book that I have ever seen in the radiology. And then as you said again, I was not a very big fan of Sutton, so I read Granger only. And then in the first year, I also read Osborne. But more important than that, what I used to do is I was very keen in learning, so I used to see cases, and whatever case I used to see, I tend to read that case as a disease point of view from the books that were available and from the online sources. So one, as you already said, I took the membership of RSNA when I was a first year resident. And at that point of time, not many people were aware that this RSNA website or membership is available free of cost to the resident. One of my friend told me that this is available, so I just did the formalities. And apart from that, there are a few more online journals, American Journal of Radiology, European Society of Radiology, they were also, some of them were available. So like I have seen a case of, let's say, retroperitoneal fibrosis. So what I used to do is I used to read about that particular case. Though in the first year or second year, you may not be able to get the detailed idea, but at least something goes in your brain.
Yes.
And once you will see more cases and once you will follow a structured pattern, then it automatically comes to you.
Yeah.
And as radiology is slowly and slowly going into the super specialization, so I feel that it also, you develop an interest.
Yes.
And then you tend to think about that after post-graduation, are you thinking of going into some specialization or not? At least this is what I have done. More important than that, because I think in every medical college, you are posted in a particular department. Like you have a posting for 1 month, at some places it is a posting for 2 months. So if you are posted for a one particular place, what I used to do is, like, let us say I am posted in barium. So I used to make sure that whatever resources that are available for a particular barium, I am completing that.
Yeah.
I feel that that is one of the biggest difference, though I may be wrong on that, and that is why I wanted your opinion, is I feel that this is one of the biggest difference between doing an MBBS and preparing for a postgraduate entrance exam and now becoming a radiologist. Now there is no limit onto the things that you can read.
And you know, nobody is going to teach you like they used to teach you during MBBS days. It is going to be, you know, self-learning.
So the spoon feeding time is over.
No, no, that is, that is a thing of past. Just forget about that.
Yeah.
And you know, these faculty members who will be there with you, they have, you know, their own, there's so many works to be done for them apart from, you know, you, of course they will teach you while doing the reporting. You will learn few pearls of wisdom from them. But most of the learning you will have to be doing on your own. That is there. And then there are a lot of conferences going on these days at ICRI. We focus, at least I focus totally on resident teaching, and we are doing a lot of activities, and I keep on communicating through different groups regarding our activities. And so, you know, for a learner, there are a lot of opportunities. And second thing to remember, nobody is going to teach you like people taught you during MBBS. You have to do, you have to learn on your own.
So, sir, actually, this reminds me to a very, 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 very pertinent question. Nowadays, we have got different courses. Now, we have got MD in radiology and we have got DNB in radiology. And we all know that not all institutes are same. There's some institutes have got very, very structured teaching programs, but some institutes, they do not have that structured teaching programs. Even in DNB, there are a lot of institutes which have got very, very structured program. But on the other hand, we know that there are a lot of institutes which don't have a structured program. The second problem that we face in the radiology is that there are a lot of medical colleges also, they do not have access to all the investigation. Like you have also run a department where the MRI was not there. So if I just put it in the question that if a radiology resident is doing his residency from an institute which does not have an access to all the modalities or to a structured program, they always feel that they have, they are lacking something. So how can they overcome this particular problem? Let's start with, let's say that what you did in your college when the students were not having access to the in-house MR.
Yeah, so that is actually you know, problem people also ask me a lot of time, that we do not have access to MR or we don't get good cases, we get normal cases. So how do we learn? Well, at UCMS, of course, we did not have MR. So we had an arrangement with some other teaching hospitals in Delhi, and our students used to go there. Similarly, these days MCI has mandated that, you know, certain instruments should be available. These include CT, these include MR and DSA also. They have to be, you know, available in the institute, or there needs to be some arrangement with some other institute which has this, so that people, the students get exposed. So just try and find out in your institute whether any such arrangements are available, and go there. And moreover, you know, there are many institutes in India which are providing these kind of training to people. Whether these trainings are available during residency, that I am not very sure of. But yes, then you attend courses, and of course, there are a lot of online teaching tutorials available. You can contact those also. But definitely, seeing the case and, you know, seeing on the, you know, on the net, that is different. You need to have first-hand exposure to the modality. You need to have first-hand exposure to the cases to be able to learn. right? So in this, I think you will have to take help of your seniors who have passed out from institute and just ask them. And then even if you don't get the opportunity, you know, you be very good in whatever you have, and then you have this opportunity in your senior residency also. These days most of the institute, they have MRI or other equipments there, and you can go there and learn MR there by doing senior residency also.
Okay, so that means it will not be a very
no,
big
no.
problem.
It will not be a very
big
problem.
That, yeah, because ultimately the basic learning you can acquire.
Yes, as long as you are willing to learn, you will learn it sooner or later.
Yeah,
that
I always
is not an
feel
issue.
That the learning depends on student.
Yes, yes.
There are a lot of students who are in very good institutes, but they are not willing to learn.
So I learned CT during my senior residency. I learned MR when I was a professor.
Okay.
So learning, you know, your
learning never stops.
Yes, it never stops.
I agree.
Yes.
I totally agree. In fact, I feel that even after completing my residency and at the senior residency, and that too from Maulana Azad Medical College, I was not very confident in reporting a musculoskeletal MR.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and when I did my fellowship, I did it from abdomen.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I was not very confident. And the first hospital that I joined in Delhi was a hospital dedicated to musculoskeletal MR.
Okay,
and all the learning of MSK MR that I did
happened
happened there. And now I can say with confidence, like as far as any MSK MR is concerned, now I get reference and opinions or on MSK MR from at Pan Delhi level. So the learning is one thing in the medical field that never stops. Every year there is something new things that has come up, and probably that changes it.
And you know, there are dedicated teaching programs going on, dedicated conference going on, which focus on a particular system or which focus on a particular modality. Right, you must attend that. And as a resident, my advice to you is you attend as many conferences as you can, because these conferences, the lectures are taken by very experienced teacher. Like in your practice, in your day-to-day practice, you would be seeing, you know, on an average, depending upon where you are placed, maybe 4 or 5 good cases. But if you go to a conference, supposing you are going to an MSK MR conference or an MSK conference, over a period of 2 days, you are seeing almost 200 cases, right? So you see 200 cases, you try and make note of them and then read about those cases when you go back from the conference. And it is always a good practice that if you attend a conference, just try and see what are the topics which are there in that conference and try and read them before you go, then see during the conference, then again try and read them. So that is a great help. You will be learning.
So one should have an early exposure towards the conferences.
Yes, yes, yes.
Very
conferences
very early
are must if you are attend. People, I have seen, like I have seen residents, some residents attending no conference at all, and some residents attending all conferences. So people who are attending conferences and participating, you know, in a very interactive manner with the faculty, they invariably do well in their exam. That
they are up to date also, up to date with the even the newer things that have come up in the society.
Yeah.
Okay, sir, another very interesting question that I come across, and which is genuine also, that it used to be said that it is difficult to enter into the MD and it is easy to pass. It is easy to enter into DNB and it is difficult to pass. But that was there when there was no entrance exam for the DNB. Now the things have changed. Now it has become even difficult to enter in DNB also. But the second part is more or less still same, that it is easy to pass an MD exam, but it is slightly difficult to pass the DNB exam. So what is your take? You have been an examiner for both the things. First of all, I want you to tell that how the MD exam is different from the DNB exam.
Well, the most important thing, difference between MD and DNB is that in MD you have your own teacher sitting as examiner. So like for example, you have 2 external, but then you have 2 internal also, and these internals, they know how good you are, and exam, you know, it's a stressful day, right? So sometimes the things can go wrong, and then these internals are there to help you. They are there to convince the external examiner that this is just a one-off thing, and otherwise the students are good. And that luxury is not available to DNB students, right? So they have to do everything on their own. First they have to pass in theory, for that they have to slog, and then again they have to pass in practicals with totally 4 different unknown examiners. So that is the main difference.
And it's a more structured exam also.
DNB is definitely more structured. They are well defined, 4 cases are there, and more or less systems are also defined, and definitely it is more structured as compared to MD examination.
One thing that student keep on asking me is that the DNB examiner is sitting to fail the student. So you have been an examiner. Tell me honestly that when you were an examiner, have you ever thought and this thought has come to your mind that you want to fail the student, or with what thought you are going? Because see, as an MD examiner, either you're going as an external or you're an internal. If you're an internal, you already know your students.
Yeah.
Okay. But if you're going as an external, you are taking the viva, but your answer is also dependent on the internal who is sitting over there. Right. I think I'm right on this. But as a DNB examiner, you don't know. There is no internal over there. You don't know the student. So you are asking the questions, and I think their pass or fail is dependent on what the student knows. But what you are asking, is it, are you asking the questions to fail the student, or are you asking the question to pass the student?
Well, I think this question is absolutely wrong. No examiner goes with the intent to fail a student, right? Examiner goes with the intent to assess the student,
yeah.
Right? And in DNB, it is more objective. That is perhaps the only difference, that in DNB, it is objective because examiner doesn't know you, and the, see, there is always this intent, you know, we know that students are nervous, they are nervous on that particular day, we don't know how far they have trained, and you know, there are different cases, some are easy cases, some are difficult cases, but the intent of the examiner is just to know whether this particular student is good enough to be left to the society,
yeah.
That he will not whether harm the society,
for the patient or not.
Whether he is safe for the patient, that is the most important consideration. And to achieve this, we just need to know how far this particular student knows. And examiner, in fact, if you ask now DNB resident, some of you would be joining DNB, DNB hospitals or institute. You ask your people who have passed out, there is always an intent to help the student in case something goes wrong. The examiner would always guide and give clues so that the examinee goes to the right path and chooses the right approach. So this particular impression that DNB student is there to fail the examiner is absolutely wrong. So what I would suggest, if you go to this exam, you have to be absolutely confident that examiner is there to help you and not to fail you. Just remember that.
Yeah. So this, that is the specific reason that I asked you this question,
yeah.
Sir. So that means basically in MD, if you are sincere during your post graduation, you will pass the exam, even if you have not performed so great during,
yes,
the day of the exam.
That actually practically,
yeah,
happens.
I know, but in DNB, if you are good in your subject, you will pass the exam.
But let me tell you, you see, DNB is a very, very all-encompassing kind of exam. Like, we have spotters, we have cases, we have physics viva. So like, an examiner is meeting a student at least 3 times, you know, for different purpose. So we are able to make out what is the average level of this particular student, so that, you know, his competence may not be, you know, performance, I would say, not competence, performance may not be as good in one of the sections, but in other sections, you see that he knows his subject well. So you form an overall impression. It is not just dependent upon one. So a person, generally these days, DNB also has very high pass rate since the time where the selection is merit based, and most of the students do actually pass. And just remember, you are assessed overall, not on just one particular aspect of the exam.
Okay. Very, very pertinent advice, specifically for those residents who have joined DNB and they think that it will be difficult to pass. See, as I told you, that learning, if you are good in your subject, you will pass DNB. And more important than that, I feel that if you are not good, what will you do after passing the exam?
And I just want, yeah, to tell one more thing. Since I have assumed charge as chairman ICRI, we are regularly conducting these orientation courses. We are conducting these mock exam sessions for students, and here again the emphasis is to tell the student what is basics, what is advanced. And last week only we conducted one mock exam session for the DNB exam going student. That was a huge hit, as far this was like told by them in feedback, and we intend to conduct more of these sessions. And I request all of you to be on lookout for these courses and join them. These kind of courses which are specifically exam focused, they do help a lot.
Okay. Any special advice to the students, sir?
Well, most important advice, number one, take care of your health. That is most important. So you, as a resident, you will be having lot of duties. Some places, less number of PGs, especially in DNB Institute. I am told that there are a lot of duties, and so you should have that work-life kind of balance. MD and DNB is, you know, just a part of your lifelong journey, and don't ever ignore your health for purpose of your, you know, this passing the examination. Then be relaxed. See, you are in radiology. Radiology means you are, I think, most of the students, they have rank above 3000 or 1000.
Yeah, sir.
Right?
Yeah, 3000, 2000 you can say.
Right. So, what does that mean? See, first you
out of 150,000.
Out of 1 lakh. First is MBBS from general population. You are a special lot. Then even among the special in radiology, you are the topmost. Right? Just remember that. That should give you a lot of confidence. Right? And do your work sincerely, because that is where the most of the learning takes place, and indulge yourself in active learning, that is by reporting more and more cases, and do not be afraid of asking questions to your seniors, to your faculty members. They help a lot, right? And learning is a lifelong process, and DNB is just your initial part of this journey. So that is all I have to say, and active learning is the most important thing, learning on the go. You know, and people who are good workers, that is what I have seen over a period of time, people who work nicely, those who take care of the patient, ultimately they turn out to be the one who have maximum knowledge and maximum practical knowledge. So please do work and report your cases. Only then you would be able to learn and be confident in exam.
Thank you very much, sir. I hope that all these doubts that students were having about this, they have been taken care of, and I'll keep asking for your advice for the students that so that they can get benefited. Thank you very much.
As an ICRI chairman and as a teacher, I just want to inform the students that I am personally also involved in a lot of teaching. I have a resident group, and if you want any advice from me personally, please note down my number. It is WhatsApp number is 9599346713. I'll repeat, 9599346713. You can contact me on this phone number if you have any doubt, and you know, for keeping abreast with whatever teaching is going on behalf of ICRI.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.